Hello friends, welcome to Code Semantic and welcome to the video tutorial of C programming. In this video, we are going to study a new concept related to C programming, that is structure in C programming. So let us see what is structure first. So let me define it. So as you can see here, it is user defined data type. Okay, so what it means basically, till now we have used many data types in C, right? All that are data types are primitive data type given by the language, that is int, float, char, etc., etc. Okay, so you can say the data types given by the languages are called as primitive data type. But in real world application, we generally required some different kind of data or different type of data. Say for example, employee, student, teacher, book. Okay, so these types are not given by the language itself. Now the first reason is that basically the requirement of a particular data type is different from user to user. Say for example, I am storing the details of student might be different than the requirement of other institution. Okay, that's why many languages provides the facility to create your own data type, and in C programming we can do it with the help of structure. Okay, again you can say it is a collection of different type of elements. Okay, you can say basically it is composed of primitive data type only. Means when we say employee, okay, so let me say we have employee. Okay, so what information we need to store regarding employee? It can be his ID, it can be his name, it can be a salary, okay, position, etc., etc., department in which he or she is working. So anything. So currently I am concerned with these three fields only. Okay, so basically you can say these three are what? Elements. So employee is my user defined data type, which is collection of these three elements, and these three elements are of different type. Means for example, ID is of type integer, name is of type string, okay, and salary is of type float. So as per this second statement, you can say it is collection of different type of elements, and this different type of elements are of primitive type. So with the help of primitive type only, you are going to create your own data type. Okay, and one more thing about structure is that it is easy to manage. Definitely as we move ahead, you will understand that how it is easy to manage. Okay, so let us see the syntax of structure. To define your own user data type, user defined data type, you have to use keyword struct. Obviously it is keyword, so it should be in a small case. So struct, struct, and then after you have to specify the name. It can be any name, but it should be a valid identifier. All of you are aware of the rules of valid identifier, okay? And then in curly braces, you will specify element along with data type. Okay, so data type, element 1. And similarly, you can define data type element n. Okay, this is element n. Okay, so you can have as many element as per your requirement. Then you will close this curly braces and terminate it by semicolon. So this is the structure syntax. Okay, so let us define one structure. Say for example, employee. So here I'll say struct. Just try to give a meaningful name, and it should be valid as well as readable. Okay, So as I said, I want to store the employee ID, which can be or which is of type integer. So I'll say ID, then name of employee. So it is going to be string, and in a C programming, we define a string as a character array, right? So name, say of size 20. Okay. And then after I want to store the salary of an employee. So I'll say float sal, then closing curly braces and semicolon. So this is the syntax, and this one is an example of structure. Okay. Now we'll study few more things related to structure. Okay. The next question is where to define this structure. Okay. Basically, if you define your structure outside the main or outside any function, it will be recognized as global structure. It will be recognized as global structure because it is available to each and every program, every function in your program. Okay. But if you define this structure inside the function, then it will be recognized as local structure. So remember this thing. So it is up to your requirement where you have to use it. Basically, we need this structure for entire program. So we define it outside the main function, means after including the header files. Okay. After including the header files, immediately we write down the syntax of structure. Okay. And then after we define our function, and at last we can define our main program. Okay. Now, the next thing is, once we define the structure, okay, memory is not allocated at that moment. When you create a variable of this structure, at that time memory will be allocated. Okay, I hope you understand this. Okay, see, we know that when we just say int, does memory will allocate? No. What we have to say? We have to say int, say ID or int X, anything, roll number, anything. Means, first of all, we have to define the data type and its corresponding variable. Then only memory get allocated, right? Similarly, when we define a structure, at that time, we are just creating our data type. When we declare the variable of type employee, at that time only memory will be allocated. Now let us see how to do declaration of a structure variable. So if you want to declare your structure variable, it is bit different from our normal declaration, because while declaring our normal variable of type primitive data type, we specify the data type first and then after comma separated list of valid variable. So here we have to use struct keyword also. Means you can't just say employee. Okay. You have to say struct employee and then after your variable. Okay. So it can be any number of variable. It depends on your requirement, how many values you want to store. Even A2, E3, even we can declare array of this, but we will come to that point later. Initially, we will study the basic concepts related to structure, and then after, as we move ahead, we will see that concept. Okay. So this is a way to declare your structure variable. Remember this thing, you can't omit this word. Okay. Now, the next thing is how to initialize it. Okay. So suppose I want to initialize this variable. How we initialize normal variable? I have to say int X is equal to 10. Means while declaration, if I assign some value, then it is called as initialization. Okay. Now I want to initialize this variable E. So what I have to do? Okay. So here only I'll define it is equal to in curly braces. You have to define the value for your element. Now, while defining the value for element, you have to take care of one thing. That is, you have to initialize it in the same order the way you define your element in your structure. Means here we define the ID and then we define name and then after we define the salary. So same order you have to follow here. Okay. So say first of all the ID is 100. Say name is of type string, so I can enclose it in double quote, right? The name is XXX. Let me erase this. Do not need this. And then after salary, say 50,000. Okay, I can't use comma separator, right? I have to just specify 50,000. That's it. So this is nothing but what? This is initialization of a structure variable. So as I said, you have to take care of one thing. It should be defined in the same order as your elements are defined. Okay. Now, the next thing is how we can access the values of element of our structure variable. Okay. So for that, one operator is given. So we are going to study the operators that we can apply on the structure. So the first operator that we are going to study is dot operator. Okay. So what dot operator does? So basically you can say it is also accessor. Okay. Because it is used to access the element of your structure variable. Means suppose I want to access this 100. Okay. So how you will access it? First of all, you have to specify your variable name. What is it? E, whatever variable name you have declared, and then after the element name. The element is what? ID. So now e.id is basically an integer type of data and you can perform any operation on it that you can perform on integer type of data. Just the way to access that element or variable is quite different. Okay, instead of ID, what we are saying? We are saying e.id. Similarly, I can say e.name, e.sal. Okay, suppose I want to print this ID. So what will I say? Printf. Definitely, I'm going to cover the input-output statement as well. So this is just for example. So ID is of type integer. So that's why %d, then comma. And instead of just ID, what you have to say? e.id. Okay, quite easy, right? Now, the second operator is size of operator. I hope you remember the size of operator. Basically, size of operator is used to calculate the memory requirement of a variable. Okay. So, here also we can use the size of operator on our structure type of data. So, if I say size of is a keyword. So, you have to write it in a small case. And then to size of operator, we have to specify the data type. So what is my data type? It is struct employee. Okay. It is not just employee. As I told you, user defined data type will be prefixed with this struct keyword. You can't just say employee. Okay. So this size of operator will give you the memory requirement of your structure variable or structure. So as you can see here, okay, my ID is of type integer and if we consider 32-bit machine, then it will acquire 2 bytes of memory. Okay, character will acquire 1 byte, 1 for each character. So here we declare an array of size 20, so it will require 20 bytes of memory. And for float, we need 4 bytes of memory. So in total, you will need 26 bytes of memory. Okay. And basically, these values are allocated consecutively in your memory location. Means first up are your ID, then after your name, and then after the salary. The order in which you define the element. And in the same way, it is allocated in a memory also. So this is one operator. Now, the third operator is assignment operator. Okay. Now again, we already studied this operator. What is this operator? Specified by equal to sign. And what it does, it assigns the value of one variable to another variable. Now just imagine that, see, currently we have this structure variable e, okay? And if I declare one more structure variable, say struct employee e1, and what I want to do, I want to assign the value of structure variable e to e1, okay? So what I can say, I can directly say e1 is equal to e, okay? There is no need to say e1.id is equal to e.id. e1.name, definitely we can't say e1.name is equal to e.name because it is string type of variable. So what we have to do, let me erase it. So here we have to say strcpy e1.name comma e.name. So these statements are generally not required. Why? Because this operator, assignment operator, does it for you. Means it copies the element, it copies the data element by element. So I hope you understand this. Okay, so assignment operator directly works on our structure variable. Okay, or definitely you can't use other relational operators. Means you can't say is e1 greater than e, or you can't say e1 is equal to e. This will not work. Means relational operator do not work. Means basically what will I say, whatever operators I told you here, dot operator, size of operator and assignment operator, only these operators are going to work on your structure variable. No other operators are applicable here. So I hope you understand what are the operators that we can apply on a structure variable. Okay, now next we are going to study input output statement. Okay, just now we saw that how to initialize our structure variable. Okay, but when initialization is useful when the values are already known. But suppose you want to accept these values from the user, so definitely we have to use input and output statements. Again, these are same as we do it for the our primitive type of data. Okay, so see, basically it is composed type having this primitive type only. You have to use just accessor along with your structure variable, means e.id, e.name, in this way. Okay, so let us see what is the input statement for it. So for inputting the value, what we use scanf. Okay, so I'll say scanf. I'm assuming that we have already declared this variable e, and again I'm going to accept the value in order. Basically there is no such a rule that you can accept the values in order only. Okay, so here I'm accepting the values in order, that is I'm accepting the value of id first, then name, and then after salary. So I have to specify the respective format specifier. For integer it is %d, right? For string it is %s, and for salary or for float it is %f. Then double quote complete, you have to use ampersand sign e.id. okay, then since for string we do not use ampersand sign, I already explained this, so you can watch the videos related to string. So here we are not going to use ampersand sign, so here I'll say e.name. And for salary, which is of type float, I have to use again ampersand sign e.sal. That's it. So quite easy. Okay, initially you are just defining that variable alone. Now you are defining that variable along with your structure variable and the dot operator. That's it. Now suppose you want to print that value. Again, in the same way, you can't just say printf e. Okay, you have to display each and every individual element separately. So again, it depends the order in which you want to show. So I'm just going to show in the same order. First of all, I'm going to say show the ID, or printing the ID. Then I'm going to display the name on the next line. That's why I'm using slash n. And %s, again slash n. Then %f. So my structure variable, and then dot operator, and then element e dot id, e dot name, and e dot sal. That's it. So this is about input and output statement. Now let us see a few more things related to structure. Okay, as I told you, we have to, while declaring the structure variable, we have to use this struct keyword. Okay, suppose you want to avoid this, there is a typedef operator, okay, or typedef statement. It allows you to rename your data type. So what you can do, you can say typedef, what is my original data type? My original data type is this. Okay, so struct employee, and suppose I want to rename it by emp. So this is my old or existing data type, and this one is my new data type. So this point onwards, after defining this typedef statement, you can declare the variable like this: emp, e1, e2, e3, etc, etc. So this typedef statement you can use with primitive data type also. I mean, suppose you want to say typedef int my int, it will also work. So from that point onwards, you can use that new type or new synonym, or you can say alias instead of the original data type. Okay, this is one thing. Now one more thing, suppose you want to declare structure variable global. Basically this statement you are going to write it in a function, okay, in main function or your own function, whatever it may be. But as I told you, we generally define the structure outside any function. And suppose you declare any variable here, okay, say e1, e2. This is also a valid syntax. Okay, you can declare your structure variable directly like this. But in that case, it becomes global. Means if you are defining your structure outside any function. But if you are defining your structure inside any function, in that case, this structure variables will be applicable to that particular function only. So this is also one valid way to declare your variable. Remember this thing. Okay. Now, before moving to complex things related to structure, we are again going to focus on one more point, that is why to use structure. See, you might find that we are initially directly saying ID, name, salary. Okay, it was good rather than define a structure, then use it variable, then dot operator, right? These questions might come to your mind, come in your mind. Okay, so I'll just try to resolve it. Why structures are useful? First of all, the first thing that I already told you, that structure variables or structures are representing the real world data. Because in real world, we hardly use or hardly say it is my integer type of data, or it is my string type of data, or general data actually represented by some entity which is nothing but an employee, teacher, book, student, right? So just to represent that real world entity, we are creating a structure here. That is one more reason. Okay, and the another reason is it is easy to manage. Okay, now how it is easy to manage? So as long as you are dealing with a single employee, okay, you find this way easy, okay, directly declaring the variables related to employee, okay, that is ID, name, and salary, instead of enclosing it in a structure. And then after creating a variable of structure and using dot operator, you can definitely go for this. But now just imagine that you want to store the details of 100 employee. You want to store the details of 100 employee. So what you have to do here? You have to say int of id 100, right? Then you have to say the char name. Okay, so number of rows will be 100 and each name will of 20 character. Then float salary of 100, then it is difficult to manage. Okay, but here what I have to say, I have to just say struct employee even of 100. Okay, now I can access each element like even of I dot id. Okay, here you have to say id of I, name of I and something. Okay, sal of I. So once your data get vast, if you are representing it through array, then structures are definitely useful and manageable. Okay, but if you are just representing your data in this way, then it is very cumbersome to manage. So that's why structures are useful. So I hope you enjoy this video. In upcoming videos, we are going to see the complex structures and some programs and definitely the other concepts related to structure. Thank you for watching.